run and it runs down the pole and it causes it.
Right, I noticed this one's got, you see the extra,
inside the pole?
You see the little extra brown stripe it's got right there on the bottom? That runs right parallel with the metal pole next to it.
Yeah.
It's like some sort of grounding's going on there, and the electricity that comes up through it grounds with the sun and maybe a little bit with that metal pole right there, and that's why the extra brown stripe that's parallel with the thing.
You can buy yourself a digital meter.
Yeah.
You can stab the prong over here, and you can actually read the power. And when it's raining, you can read the power, and you can, in millivolts.
Uh-huh. I think they're preventatively putting braces on these, because I have video of one in Tremont in Utah where you can see a big old pit's burned right out of it, and they put a metal brace on there to keep it from falling.
Well, it'll arc over.
Right. There's been some sort of burning there, and I think they're preventatively. They take prods, like you were saying, and find the ones that are maybe in danger of burning and put braces on them, and they're drilling lag bolts. A recent video someone else sent me is lag bolts they're putting in right about 2 or 3 foot up. Lag bolts in there to maybe give the energy a place to release.
Okay, I'll tell you a place you can go look at power poles in the United States.
You hear that? He said, I'll tell you a place you can go look to see some power poles. It's hard to turn it up and down.
We just finished building a new power plant in Mount Provo, Kansas, Homestead.
Uh-huh.
The old original Homestead plant that was built there in 1904.
Okay. In the mouth of Provo Canyon, right, up there on the left. I've seen it.
Yeah, it's the old one. Right, because you turn in the mouth of the canyon, you can't get in there because it's owned by Central Utah Water Association. But we built the new one right above the old one.
Okay.
And that was the first place in the world, supposedly, that they put together three-phase electrical power. Westinghouse came out and they built the transformers and they put it on a power line and they ran the power line from there over the mercury guy into the mine. First over three-phase power transmitted overland. You can look it up, Olmsted, OLM.
Huh.
Put that.
He said you can look it up. I'll even spell it for you. O-L-N-E-E-D. I haven't been able to find it. Maybe I didn't do an extra E. But this is where he starts to tell me. And if you listen close, he says magnetic field. He says, well, bottom line, it's electrolysis when we start talking about it some more.
They got that. They got a new look up in. When you look it up, it shows the new plant and everything that we put together and that. But if you go up above there, you can get in there if you go up 800 north.
Here's where he's telling me how to get in there, where a minute ago he said you can't get in there because it belongs to Utah Power. But here's where he tells me during hunting season there's an open gate, and if you go up 800 north past the graveyard, he explains to me how to get in there and find more of these poles.
You go on 800 east, you go north on 800 east, and there's a graveyard there.
Yeah, I worked there. The old cemetery, memorial, something memorial.
Whatever, anyway, you turn right there and go up on the hill.
Uh-huh.
And you can go up and you go through the gate. I don't know if the gate's open yet, but they open the gate during hunting season. Both power lines are run out of there. They've been in there since the poles that I had, some of the poles that they had us take down. I had some. I saved these when we tear things down.
Uh-huh.
These gate tags. Well, the old punch ones, I had a couple of them, 1938 poles, and they were...
That's old. Yeah, these ain't going to last that long. Hey, I got to finish my video, but right down here on 200 North and 200 East, there's a guy that's put out a big log, and you'll be able to see what I'm talking about. It's burning the inside, and the electricity courses its way through the inside. 200 North, 200 East, someone else has seen it and put that out there for display.
What it comes down to the bottom line, they call it electrolysis.
Okay. Right, and it uses the smoke as a medium. He said, what it comes down to is the bottom line is they call it electrolysis. During that electrolysis, to rust the cars rust instantly in these weird fires. Yeah, I talked to a guy online, he's a metallurgist from the Northeast. He knows a lot more about it than me, but he says it's electrolysis.
Electrolysis is huge, you know, just because anything metal that you put in the ground.
Uh-huh. Right.
It's like magnetic fields.
Right. Did you hear what he just said? I don't know. Something's magnetic field.
Yeah.
We'll do that again.
Here's where he starts really cutting loose. He says anything metal that you put in the ground draws that current. And he even mentions anode tubes here in a minute. But out of nowhere, he says, oh, magnetic field. I didn't say the magnetic field. He said magnetic field.
Anything metal you put in the ground,
current in it all the time.
Right.
He said, I don't know, plus magnetic fields. Here's where he talks about the deterioration and how anode tubes are used to mitigate that deterioration.
It's in a pipeline. Most of your pipelines you can see now, the weld wires, joint to joint, that's so that they can bring it out. And then they bring it in, they have big anode fields that they bury away from the pipe and in the ground, the pipe out away from that, and it stops the
electrolysis. It stops the electrolysis. That's the other thing I've discovered. The magnetic field, fluctuations in the magnetic field lead to surge in ground current. There's someone else that knows more about that than me that I've gleaned some of their information.
But I don't understand it, but
I think it's part of the the magnetic field weakening and fluctuating creates these ground current surges, and they're kind of playing with that a little bit artificially. So yeah, check out you sound like you know enough about the electricity that you'll be able to go down there and look at that tree stump the guy put on 200 North, 200 East. And you'll scratch your head, man. Have a good one, brother.
And that's how I was hoping to end the conversation.
So, we will go down here.
That's how I was hoping to end the conversation with the guy on the four-wheeler. Have a good one, brother. That guy obviously knew more than he was leading on when he first started out saying it's just the hot weather and the creosote. By the end, he's talking about magnetic field, electrolysis, anything metal you stick in the ground, it'll draw that current. Yeah, that guy knew a lot more than he led on to at first. And then he gave me directions where I could find more of those poles at a place where it's not normally open to the public because it belongs to Utah Power. But there's a road. He gave me the secret road that's only open during hunting season. He says, I don't think it's open yet, but during hunting season, they open it up. Here's where he's giving me directions, and I start saying something about the cemetery. He says, yeah, whatever. I'm telling you something here, kid. Pay attention. And he says, I don't know if the gates are open yet. Some hunting season, something.
Memorial.
Whatever. Anyway, you turn right there and go up on the hill.
Uh-huh.
And you go up and you go through the gate. I don't know if the gate's open yet, but they open the gate during hunting season.
They open the
gate. Power lines can run out of there.
I don't know if the gate's open yet, but they open the gate during hunting season and the power lines that they run out of there.
Yeah, they've been in there since. The poles that I have, some of the poles.
So you heard him say, you want to know where to find some more of those poles earlier. Here where I'm telling him about the lag bolts they're putting in for that burning, that energy to release, is where he says, I'll tell you a place you can go look for power poles at 1120 something.
Right about 2 or 3 foot up. Lag bolts in there to maybe give the energy a place to release.
I'll tell you a place you can go look for power poles.
He said, I'll tell you a place you can go look for power poles. So by the end, I turned this guy, and at first he was playing dumb. By the end, he was knowing enough about electricity that we were able to have a good, cordial conversation. The other two that said they did it, I don't know what's going on here, if there's a coordinated effort by an organization or if it's just individuals who take the download. But this guy's living proof that for some reason he started out playing dumb, and by the end he was telling me where I could find more poles, saying, I don't know, something with the magnetic field, and it, bottom line is, it's electrolysis. Well, that ain't what you said at first. You said creosote. Down here on the timestamp, by 11:02, he says, Yeah, it arcs over, because I'm telling about this metal pole right here and the burn line right there and the lag bolts they put in there to prevent that. At 11:02, he says it arcs over at 11:22. He says, well, I'll tell you where you can go find you some poles.
Tremont in Utah, where you can see a big old pit's burned right out of it, and they put a metal brace on there to keep it from falling.
Well, it'll arc over.
Right. There's been some sort of burning there, and I think they're preventatively. They take prods, like you were saying, and find the ones that are maybe in danger of burning and put braces on them, and they're drilling lag bolts. A recent video someone else sent me is lag bolts they're putting in right about 2 or 3 foot up. Lag bolts in there to maybe give the energy a place to release.
Okay. I'll tell you a place you can go look for power poles.
Tying it all in together, back to Marfugel's moon wobble video. This guy that he has on from Wages World says you'd know it if the Earth was like tipping sideways. You mean like Orion's Belt and the Three Kings rising vertical and setting horizontal, and or the moon doing the same means the axis has tilted far enough we can see a 90 degree rotation every single day in the moon and the stars? The fact that we don't have tidal waves does not negate what we can see in the sky.
So, you know, it's going to change. Things are going to change. Are things speeding up? Things are just now starting to show up. And, you know, there's a lot of things out there. People talk about like an immediate, like, tilt to our side and all those kinds of things. Man, we wouldn't even have to question if that happened. You know, just imagine you're holding a bowl of water, and you automatically you get jerked to the side. What happens to the bowl? Well, it's way over there, but the water hits the floor. I mean, that's the stuff that we're talking about here. And it's the same thing with tides. You know, our waters are in basins. We start moving.
Okay. So the fact that we don't see tidal waves doesn't negate what we do see in the sky, which indicates a major and immediate tilt to the side. We wouldn't even have to question it. Well, I think we should start questioning it because I can see it and they're trying to show us. When NASA's coming out with the moon wobble, Marf's doing a video with moon wobble in the title, zero people in the comments section mention they can see it turn 90 degrees every night. And it does this at every phase of the moon. It's just easiest to see at half moon. Right now, it's just over half moon, but you can still see it even at full moon if you watch closely enough. But when it's at half moon, it's undeniable. On one horizon, vertical light line. On the other horizon, horizontal light line. That is a 90 degree turn. So I beg to differ with the guy who says, we wouldn't even have to question. No, by the appearance of the sky, we have made a big turn. And it was about a year ago that I was saying, Marf had a episode where he was showing the Inuit elders, the Alaskan Inuit elders, say that we've tilted and that the sky has changed. As if that was an authoritative source. Like, wouldn't NASA be able to tell us? And isn't that more authoritative than the Inuit, Alaskan and Native Inuit elders? They were trying to tell you, but put it off on the elders or something. And the tilt in our axis and the diminishing magnetic field prior to pole shift may be what's causing the plasma fires. But they would rather you thinking it's directed energy weapons, so they're broadcasting that in mainstream now. Washington Post, I believe it was. Washington Times. Whatever mainstream news article that was we just looked at. They want you looking in the direction of the directed energy rather than the undirected energy. The uncontrollable energy, because directed energy is controllable. You will still seek their guidance. And obey their governance. Which is a good thing, because if everyone knew what you can clearly see in the sky with your own eyes, we'd be in trouble. Because their consciousness is not raised to the level where they can see it in the sky at night with their own eyes. They're focused on other stuff. Like Owen Benjamin said, they're watching too much porno and jerking off, and masturbating has made them go blind. And we'll talk more about that chrism oil as soon as we get this bug off my screen. You see, they want you thinking that those directed energy weapons are coming from something like this. Which they may be, because logic before authority, uncloaked, one of these above the Notre Dame Cathedral on the day that it burned. Why that bug won't get off my screen, I don't know, but I knew it was going to do that. Logic before authority had a video. It was from the Westinghouse Hotel across the street from Notre Dame Cathedral on the day that the spire got hit with high energy. And for a frame or two, and it only takes a frame every 5 minutes, so this thing could have been visible for multiple minutes, and only got a single frame on the Westinghouse Hotel video camera from across the street that takes a time lapse. But for one of those images, there was one of these clearly visible. Notice one of them has the fins on the back, the other does not. Oh, and by the way, big shout out to the contributors to tonight's show. This has almost all been viewer-driven content. Things that people suggest to me via text message and in the comment section. My Nizzle Eddie Pizzle, Sam I Am. Thanks to all y'all. We got a good show tonight. You want to see some more of those triangular craft with the fins on the back? Watch this one called Santilli Telescope Proofs, Collective Initiation, You're All Freemasons, A Sun Behind the Sun. I mislabeled it. I had the title. I didn't have the Santilli Telescope part in the title. I buried the headline. But this top image of the thumbnail tells it all. This thing right here is what Ilana Freeland refers to as a microwave thruster or high volt tether. It's also what the lady on Final Days refers to as the bell-shaped craft that flies in front of the sun every time there's an eclipse. This is the red celestial object being eclipsed. The sun is right over here in these images. From right here between the sun, where you can clearly see the sun's over here emitting light, and this object is where I zoomed in and took X-ray images of the airborne aircraft carrier. The Department of Defense recently came out and acknowledged building an airborne aircraft carrier. And the reason I call them X-ray images is because I believe that's how we're able to see through the depth and see what looks like blueprints of the machinery of the aircraft carrier. And we can see the triangular craft parked 2x2x2. And at the end of runways. I did a video recently covering this. This is a good extension thereof. This is things that we did not look at on that video. So for those who are interested in some of that Santilli telescope and that X-ray images of the airborne aircraft carrier stuff, this is actually probably the best video I have on the subject that I've made. But I mistitled it that you're all Freemasons now. I buried the Santilli telescope stuff, which is actually the basis of the substance of this video. So if you are interested in that type of thing from my other recent videos covering it, this one is one you'll want to watch.
I believe now more than ever that each of us are Freemasons, and that I am sharpening your stones as much as you're sharpening mine. And yesterday, Sterling Lee, a man I respect, posted something on one of my videos about, but when you really understand, James, we are all one. We are all one. And I'm not here to fight with Sterling. I'm not here to make him feel bad. I'm not here to win an argument. I'm here to sharpen your stone. And when you talk like that, when you say, where we go one, we go all, and I know, Sterling, you're not a Q fan. I totally get it. But I want you to understand that when you adopt this philosophy that all is one, you are wasting the secretion of amnesia that God put so much time in so you could find yourself. And that we find ourselves constantly struggling to ground in who we are. And to hate the ego right now is exactly what keeps your mind like veal. Not saying you hate the ego, Stro. But that yourself is going to be the hardest place to be, and it's going to be the only place that you will survive. And that the people that love you are the ones that are sharpening you as fast as they can. Show up with the dirtiest hands you can. Show up with the most mistakes in the back of your fucking truck. You will thank me. You won't remember who I am. You'll be back with God. You'll be one again. You'll know everything, and you'll miss the opportunity to dance with mystery. That every day you had a chance, you fucking clung to shit because you wanted to know. And people will know voting is real the same way they'll know COVID is real. They'll know those things. Do you know why they'll know it? Because someone told them. Because someone told them. We have a lot of work to do. We have a lot of stone to sharpen. You're a Freemason. You are. I get it. Oh my God, Freemason! But most of you guys have already fucking left who were on that kick. The rest of you that are still here, I know we just started streaming again, so probably some of you are like, Freeman, what the fuck's wrong with this guy? I get it. I don't need you to stay. I need to sharpen the stones that are still here. And I'm going to take you fucking down, buddy. Because I know that when I take you down, someone else who's watching, someone else who doesn't have to know something, is going to see how foolish you were for insisting you had the fucking answer. Those are training wheels. Those are braces on your teeth. Yeah. Anyway.
So you may recall me having said something along the lines of no one gets on board thinking they know something, and that you are the Illuminati, a small group of people who know far more about the way this world works than the people around you, and that this is the collective initiation, as spoken of by Greg Braden. We'll get back to some more of that. This is today's video by James True called New Moon, and the link is in the description. Now we're going to go over this Santilli telescope, which was only invented in 2015, was it released to the public, and Santilli, the scientist who released the truth bringer, as they call it, this Santilli telescope. His theories are debunked by mainstream science as fringe science, but what I'm about to show you is that this Santilli telescope method absolutely works 100%, and I would like to ask for some audience participation. That'll come a little bit later. So, today Boogeyman put out another video regarding this Santilli telescope, and we'll just go ahead and watch a second of that now because it is a good educational video. And he brings up a white paper that came from Harvard.edu that confirms and validates not only the usefulness of the Santilli telescope, but that we will need to employ it in order to detect invisible, unwanted surveillance above us in our skies. So, without further ado, let's hear what he has to say just for a second.
This video is going to be broke up into a few different parts. First off, we're going to learn how to shoot the dome. And here it is. Now, you want to hit the sweet spot, and it's this dark area of the glass, right where...
Okay, that's about enough. So he goes over basically a tutorial about how to use this Santilli telescope, but I think he may also be doing a disservice and discrediting the Santilli telescope at the same time, or could be just drip-feeding into the consciousness of the public... The fact that this method works to reveal things above our head that do not fall within our scope of reality without throwing people into shock and showing them what's really there. Because the images that he keeps showing, You have to twist your mind in order to see anything, and some of them are just so ridiculous that if anyone watches this boogeyman video and the images he's pulled from his Santilli telescope, and then I tell them, oh yes, that is exactly the same method by which I was able to extract images of the airborne aircraft carrier. Here, check this out. They will laugh. Oh, if they've seen Boogeyman's video first, and I tell them Santilli telescope, they will go, oh, how much do I have to bend my mind and squint my eyes to see whatever it is that you're imagining? Rather than what I'm about to show you that is undeniable, absolute, 100% certain, enough to convince a normie that we're not in Kansas anymore. And that's why I question the method of Mr. Boogeyman here and what his true intentions are. Because this is also a Santilli telescope, which I extracted the images from that I'm about to show you, that are so clear, you don't have to squint your eyes or bend your mind. So, this video is by a YouTube channel called KCKid913. Very small channel. The fact that I came across this and the fact that I extracted these images, along with the story about the fact that I went out to Missouri and went to this guy's house, because he invited me there. And later on, before he met me or shook my hand, I never even got to see the guy. And he told me, get your car out of my driveway and don't ever come back again. There's a little drama there. We'll talk about that. But starting at the beginning, somehow this came across my... I somehow came across this. Now look how amateur this is, and recognize that you and everyone you know can begin to do this. And maybe that's what Boogeyman's trying to do. He's trying to get other people to extract the real images, and that's why he's just kind of showing you blurry, grainy crap. But what I'm going to show you is that this Santilli telescope method works. And remember again, it was only released to the public in 2015. And this guy, KC Kid, made this video in 2019. So within the 4 years that it had been released to the public, he was already receiving knowledge. Look how amateur that is. He's hanging it out his car window. It consists of a glass dome magnifier and a beautification mirror that also magnifies. You know, you can buy them at the beauty store, the mirror that magnifies your face. And you can buy one of these glass dome magnifying glasses at Staples. So you can see how